Ever since they formed, sea and land have been in perpetual conflict. It's a conflict the sea always wins. When waves break on rock, it's the rock that is broken. Its foundations undermined, its weak spots exposed, till it fractures and disintegrates. Its fragments pounded and polished into pebbles. In time, even the hardest rock can be reduced to fine sand, to a carpet of debris spread over the shore, perpetually sifted and relaid by the ebb and flow of the tide. Along the coast, eroded material is usually deposited close to the rocks it came from. But the same process is at work far beyond the shoreline. The eroding power of water carried far inland, wherever there's a wind to take it. In the mountains, bare rock gradually breaks down under the crumbling action of frost, leaving its fragmented surface open to the weathering action of rain. As snows melt and rain runs off the slopes, gravity gives water remarkable power. The power literally to move mountains. As streams join and gather speed, their erosive power increases. Twice the speed quadruples the power. In times of flood, even large boulders can be overturned and sent bouncing down gullies and ravines, crashing over falls, dislodging more rock as they go. Along the way, the torrent cuts its channel deeper. The softer rock worn away fast, the harder gradually undermined by the grinding action of gravel and the scouring of coarse sand. In this way, the work of a single season may spread tons of rock over a valley floor. Over millions of years, high mountains become gentle hills. Their remains spread over rolling plains and broad river valleys, where the forces of erosion become less violent, but no less powerful. In its middle course, the action of a river is different. In flood, it may still be rolling boulders along its bed and scouring its channel both deeper and wider. But as it broadens and slows, its main burden becomes smaller particles of sediment, fine silt and clay, carried along in suspension. Throughout its length, a constant process of wearing away, moving along, and redepositing its load, gradually carrying the sediments further and further from their original source till they reach the coast. In a single year, the world's rivers remove some 8,000 million tons of material from the land and dump it out at sea. And it's here, with the continuous settling onto the seabed of fine sediment derived from the land, that the environment is created for the formation of oil and gas. For untold millions of years, the seabeds of the world remained inert and unproductive. The momentous development that turned them into the source rocks of oil and gas was the evolution of life. Just as mountains are uplifted and weathered away, so the stuff of life is constantly being recycled. Complex organic molecules based on carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen, broken down into simple chemicals, the nutrients and building blocks of new life. Whereas the main agent of erosion is water, the breakdown of organic matter is largely due to microscopic organisms, their action dependent on the oxygen present in air and water. First to attack are the fungi, using enzymes to extract the sugars and starches they need for survival. Then bacteria, their colonies multiplying as they feed on the waste, and along with the fungi release back to the environment the basic substances needed to sustain the cycle of growth. In the normal course of events, the recycling of organic matter is efficient and complete. But not always. In this hot and humid coastal swamp, plant life grows in rich profusion. Here, in the tropics, the cycle of growth and decay has no season. Both are constant. With so much decaying organic matter falling into the stagnant swamp, the water turns acid and microbial action is suppressed. Continually fed by fresh material, the swamp becomes a burial ground in which the remains of the forest are preserved. If the process continues for millions of years, its debris will turn into peat and eventually into coal and gas, trapped deep underground. Oil is formed in a similar way, but the process begins not in a swamp, but at the bottom of the sea. At sea, life is most abundant in the photic zone, the top 200 feet of water penetrated by sunlight. At the very beginning of the food chain, and invisible to the naked eye, the most abundant form of all, the microscopic plankton. Some are animals, minute but complex creatures dependent on an external source of food, on simple single-celled plants, the various forms of marine algae. Those that are not consumed by other creatures eventually die and begin to sink below the reach of sunlight. Here they come under attack from bacteria, their material broken down and recycled in the same way as on land. But in some places, where the depths are undisturbed by the ocean currents that normally supply fresh oxygen, the process of decomposition can be suppressed, just as it is in a swamp. In such conditions, partially decayed algae continue to sink and accumulate on the stagnant seabed, along with the dead remains of exhausted bacteria. As they sink into the soft ooze and are covered over, the essential preconditions are created for the formation of oil. Most of the oil so far discovered was formed from deposits like this. But in some cases, the seabed was further enriched by material that came from the land. With the onset of the tropical rains, coastal swamps begin to flood. As the water table rises, the stagnant water begins to move, washing forest debris out to sea. Sinking to the seabed, plant remains resistant to microbial decay add to the organic buildup. Material that could in time be transformed into the lighter hydrocarbon molecules of the petroleum gases. But such a time is still a long way off. Millions of years must pass, in which layer builds on layer, succeeding layers weighing down on those beneath, till they turn once more into solid rock, hundreds, even thousands of feet thick. Where subsequent movement of the Earth's crust has raised such an accumulation back above the surface, we can begin to appreciate its scale. Here, on the south coast of England, a cliff face 150 million years old. 60 meters of organic-rich sediment deposited at the rate of a mere 8 centimeters in 1,000 years. The whole cliff taking close on 1 million years to build. There are rocks of the same age and character that are over 6 million years thick and still deeply buried, the source of the oil and gas now being recovered from the North Sea. Discovering what causes oil and gas to be formed has meant examining samples of buried sediment recovered from many locations and from different depths. Here, in a section of marine sediment magnified 160 times, we can see quite clearly the long sausage-like shapes of partially decomposed algae. From another site, a section enriched with plant remains revealed under ultraviolet light the distinctive shapes of pollen, shiny nodules of resin, the spores of a tropical fern, and fragments of waxy leaf. As the burden of overlying sediment increases, the organic matter is gradually compacted into a dense mass. As it subsides deeper into the Earth's crust, the temperature rises. This now becomes the dominant factor. Around 90 degrees centigrade, the kerogen, as it is now called, begins to undergo a remarkable transformation. The bonds between carbon atoms begin to break and reform, the kerogen elaborating into a complex range of hydrocarbon molecules. Here, from a depth of 2,000 meters and glowing in ultraviolet light, the start of the process. Marine algae turning into oil. Cooked for long enough, the larger molecules gradually break down into lighter, liquid compounds, until at a depth of around 3,000 meters, the weight of the overlying sediments forces the liquid hydrocarbons out, cracking the rock that has imprisoned them for perhaps 100 million years. As more oil is generated, the rock becomes increasingly fractured. Microscopic fissures appear, forming the pathways along which the oil is finally expelled from its source rock. Where the source rock is in contact with a porous layer filled with water, such as sandstone, the oil, being lighter than water, begins to displace it, pushing upwards through the spaces between the grains. Always taking the easiest route, it fingers its way through the more permeable areas where the pore space is unconstricted and open like a sponge. But if it encounters a layer of impermeable rock, a band of shale, for instance, its buoyancy will take it in whichever direction the layer tilts upwards. Following the incline, it travels along the roof of the sandstone. But where it encounters a fracture running through the shale, it will immediately resume its upward course. In this way, the oil may travel over great distances for as long as the source rock continues to generate it. Billions of gallons on the move, spreading out through the sedimentary basin wherever the rock layers provide a pathway, an escape route to the regions of lower pressure above. But at any time on its tortuous journey, its progress may be blocked, and the oil begin to back up and accumulate. What causes this to happen can sometimes be seen where rocks are exposed at the surface. Sedimentary rocks that were once horizontal, now tilted and folded, contorted and broken by the periodic warping and flexing of the Earth's crust. Sometimes convulsive, sometimes imperceptibly slow, these disturbances extend deep down towards the mantle and can distort the rock layers on a scale as great as the Alps or even the Himalayas. It's to contortions like this that we owe the existence of large accumulations of oil that would otherwise have dispersed to the surface and been lost. The classic oil trap is a dome-shaped fold in which the top of a porous layer is sealed by a caprock of impermeable shale. On arrival, the oil would have contained gases in solution, but once trapped, these would have gradually separated out to occupy the crest of the dome, and the groundwater would have been displaced downwards to occupy the flanks. Elsewhere, the rock layers may have been split by a fault and displaced sharply up or down, the movement producing a smear of pulverized rock down the fault line, thick enough to block the oil's passage. Or it may be a change in the nature of the rock itself that has created a trap, like this tongue of sand thinning out between two layers of mudstone, the result of an ancient coastline changing as the sea periodically advanced and retreated over the land. Whatever the cause, traps like these may be scattered throughout the area surrounding the original source rock, forming reservoirs of oil and gas, often many kilometers in extent. What began as countless billions of microscopic creatures falling year after year onto the seabed has now become a vast store of fossil energy imprisoned deep underground. Many of the reservoirs so far discovered have been in existence for 50 million years or more, the largest estimated to contain over 80 billion tons of oil. But our knowledge that they existed at all dates back scarcely more than a century, to the time when men first started probing the earth to discover the source of the seepages of oil and gas they found at the surface. We now think that far more oil and gas has escaped in this way than has ever been trapped underground. But from those hidden reservoirs has come the energy to power the 20th century. Learning how to find them has been one of the great adventures of our time.